you, Lord, for the strength you give to simply carry on through life's toils and tests and the worst and best. I'm not ever left alone. You're always right beside me. You hear me every time I pray. And since I first began, you've been my dearest friend. I will give you all the praise. I'm blessed abundantly. I can't forget that moment when in my life you made such a change. And since the Spirit's came, I've not been the same. I just want to give you thanks.
I just want to say
we
your Bibles there to John chapter number 4. I want to read just a few verses, if you will. Stay with me this morning. The Bible says in verse number 25. Latter part of this text, we'll backtrack in a moment. It says, "The woman saith unto him, I know the Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he come, he will tell us all things. Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. And upon this came his disciples and marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, Why, what seekest thou, or what talkest thou with her? Why talkest thou with her? The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and saith unto the men, Come see a man which has told me all the things that I ever did. Is not this the Christ? Then they went out of the city and came unto him. And in the meanwhile, the disciples prayed him, saying, Master, eat. But he said unto them, I have meat to eat that ye know not of. Therefore said unto the disciples one to another, Hath any man brought him aught he eat? You may stop there just for a moment. When you come to this text, it's very obvious that pretty much that the lady begins to stand up. And let me help you understand by breaking down that this lady is somebody that Jesus has passed by to come see. And he begins to take the time and the liberty to be able to reveal himself. In other words, he is very patient and begins to allow her to be able to see something that she knows to be a truth, but she has never identified who or what truth really is. If it was today in 2015, it would be the typical person that comes to church on a Sunday morning, sits on the pew. You know the truth. You know that the Bible says that there is a God and there is a Christ, and he died and hung on the cross, rose on the third day. And because of that, we celebrate Easter. And to us, most of the time, if we was to ask you who Jesus is to you, the easiest reply that you might have would be something like this, that he's the reason we celebrate Christmas and he's the reason we celebrate Easter. And that is probably the extent to a lot of people, but you would still identify and even agree that Jesus Christ is real and Jesus Christ did die on the cross. And you can probably come to a place to where that has been a conclusion in your mind. And she is stating something to Jesus. And she begins to speak to him and she says, I know that there is a Messiah. And she says, which is called Christ. And she says, there's a truth that is here. So it would be like somebody walking in today, and whatever it might be for salvation. And some of you today are lost and may not know for sure that you're saved by the grace of God. And there's a lot of you that probably is saved and know that if you died that you would go to heaven. Don't cut this off so quickly to be able to think that this is not for you, because a lot of times that we that are saved, we might know that there is resurrection power in Christ to be able to get saved from our sins and the things we go through, but we neglect the power, hey, that God has actually given when the blood of Christ was shed, not just to be the very atonement for us, to be the substitute for our sins, but it's the same power that gives us strength to be able to pray and to be able to receive grace and mercy and help. And today we might need help today. So let's look unto Christ to realize that God is the very one that we need in this hour. The Bible says that Jesus replies, and it's almost as Jesus, if she was the congregation and he was the preacher. And he says, whatever it is that you're looking for, Jesus says, I am he. Today I can't do that because I'm not Christ. I don't have a perfect rector. My character is nowhere near what it needs to be to even be suitable, to even be recognized, to be able to say that I'm even worthy of such. But there's one thing that I do, the same thing as Jesus begin to respond, listen to me and say that I am he. This morning when I begin to respond to you, you say, Brother Jason, it's salvation, it's brokenness, it's scars, it's fears, it's sin. Listen, I don't know why you're here. There's something that's going on, an inadequacy. There's something that you can't overcome. There's a storm and you're wanting to know, is there something to be able to help you? Listen, I can't say that I am he, but the very fix to your problem, your storm, your situation, your frustration, your complacency, whatever it is that you have need of today, I am preaching the word of God where the Bible says that God is alive and God is well, and you need to be able to understand that if you could just see Jesus this morning and not just see a sermon and see a song and see everything else, hey, that God can help you and God can fix you. But you've got to see Christ and not see man. So many times we hear scripture, we hear things, but we allow it to go in one ear and out the other. But the Bible says that Jesus made it plain that whatever you need, I am He. Can I say this before I go any further with my introduction this morning? Whatever it is that's in your life that's lacking and that you're longing for and needs to be put together so you can make sense of it, maybe even find a way through the darkness, it's not going to be found in pills and bottles, and it's not going to be found in doctors and psychiatrists and counselors, and they all had their place. It's not going to be found in your money and your position and that job promotion that you might want. It might not be the healing of your body that you're praying for so that you can realize that God is real. Whether God gives you money or gives you health or gives you a fix or gives you something that you long for, listen, Christ is all that you need.
Amen.
When you walk out of here this morning, if there's something that is itching at your heart, if you want to say it that way, maybe there is something that is in your mind that begins to spin and you begin to ponder the thought of how am I going to put this together? How am I going to get to where I need to get? I want you to know that you need to look unto Jesus. Don't think just because you come to church today that everything's going to work out. The Bible says that after he spoke those words, listen to this, the Bible says that the disciples walked up. And it says, and upon this came his disciple and marveled that he had talked with the woman. I mean, literally, the point was, is when you go back into verse number 8 of chapter number 4, the Bible says that Jesus had sent the disciples off to be able to go get meat as if he was hungry. And here the disciples walk back and they're thinking, okay, wait a minute. Jesus Christ is hungry. We're doing these things. We're going to get him food. And we walk back up and he is sitting here talking to a woman. And they begin to ponder in their mind, not knowing literally what was going on. And they could not put the pieces together. And they were so confused. And the reason was, is because when Jesus had spoke to the disciples, he had told them, he says, I must go through Samaria. And they had no clue why something like this was going on. The reason why it was so ironic to them is because Jews did not cross paths with Samaritans. They were literally at war, if you will, and here they're at a place to where when the Jews begin to look at them because of everything that they had known, stay with me this morning, when everything that they know, they looked at the Samaritans to be able to have a form of godliness, but not denying the form thereof, or a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, and they were wicked, and they were distraught, they were confused, they were unclean, they were somebody that had no business being around God and God's people, they had no business being around anything that was spiritual. That Samaritan people were wicked and undeserving, and they thought, why in the world is Jesus Christ hanging out with somebody so pathetic? Why in the world is Jesus hanging out with somebody so unclean? Why in the world is Jesus, who's the Son of God, the sinless Son of God, that ain't never committed a sin, why in the world is he sitting down and talking to a woman when he told us that he was hungry and he's sitting here and he's talking to a lady that is filthy, that is wretched, that is rotten, that has no hope, no possibility, there's nothing in her life that is good. They begin to think, is he a hypocrite? Because here we are supposed to be living right and he's reaching down talking to this woman. Today, that might not mean a lot to you, but it would a whole lot if you could identify with that woman when the thought of unclean comes in. Because there ain't one person in here, I don't care how long you've been saved and how good your tie looks on you, it makes no difference to me and it does not impress God when it comes down to the main thing. And the main thing is this, as we ought to thank God that when we came in unclean, whether we was unclean from a bottle or unclean from a pill or unclean because of pornography or unclean because of living out in idolatry and all these other things or unclean because of adultery or unclean because of our mouth or unclean because of our thoughts or unclean because of sitting on the pew and acting like that we were self-righteous but yet not being saved. Hey, ain't you glad for the time, hey, that when you were unclean and nobody ever took a time for you and nobody ever even talked to you and the world had turned back and mom and daddy had even turned back and the preachers had time to turn back. Hey, but Jesus showed up to where you was. He knew about the bottle. He knew about the pill. He knew about the problem. He knew about the issues and Jesus looked on you with compassion and he says that I have come. Hey, that you might be set free. As the Bible says, for he hath made him to be sin for us. That means if you're a drunkard today, hey, that Jesus died on the cross as a drunkard. If you're a harlot today, that Jesus died on the cross as a harlot. Hey, if you're somebody today with no faith, no hope, and you've got a filthy mouth, then he died that way. And Jesus did it all just to set you free. The Bible says that he begins to step up to the place and they begin to criticize and they begin to wonder, why sitting with this unclean woman? Why in the world would you take time for this unclean woman? The mistakes that she made, the idolatry that was in her life, the failures that was in her life. Why in the world would you, Jesus, be talking to her? Sounds a lot like a church people today. Sounds a whole lot like church people. People that are confused and broken and wounded and not deserving of anything. And all of a sudden you begin to reach down and you walk into a church service and say, oh, I don't want to go to that church because so-and-so goes there. And I don't want to go to that church because so-and-so goes there. Yeah, I know what they did last week. And I know what they did last summer. I know what they did the last time when I was around them. And today, so many people's caring. Listen to me. I'm telling you, there ain't one person in here. The Bible says there's no good, none good, no, not one. There's not one of us that is righteous. There's not one of us that has righteousness. And that is not as filthy rags. Our goodness is not unclean. Every single one of us have sinned and messed up. We still fall short every day. The Bible says that Paul says, I die daily. He made it plain in Romans chapter number 7. Hey, most of you think that you can't get out. You're still wallowing around in your mess. You're confused. You're hurt. You've got shame on your head. You're worried about who knows it. Hey, but let me tell you, with a man that was after God's heart, hey, that was the greatest missionary maybe that had ever lived, and he loved God, and he changed his way. You know what he said, knowing God and the grace of God and the goodness of God, even in the presence of that moment, he said it this way: in me dwelleth no good thing. That thing which I do is what I don't want to do, and the things that I do is what I don't not want to do. He said, I'm in a place where I'm fighting the flesh all the time. I'm struggling, I'm suffering, I'm overwhelmed, I'm confused. And he knew that it was hard to be able to go on. And I want to tell you today that though people have pushed you away, and though sometimes it seems like there's no hope, there's a God in heaven that still cares about you and loves you in spite of where you are or where you came from. And it don't matter how you've got tagged or what cloud is floating over your head. It don't matter the sin and the baggage that come in on your back today. It don't matter the way that you feel because of everything that's going on. Hey, listen, there's still a way to get to Jesus. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. He says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Why are you quoting that scripture, Brother Jason? Hey, because you need to know you ain't going to heaven. Hey, because your mama saved. And you ain't going to heaven because your daddy's saved. And you ain't going to heaven because you come to church. And you sure ain't going to heaven because you sing in the choir. You might have got baptized. That'll make you go to heaven. You might put a money in the offer plate. That'll make you go to heaven. The Bible says the only name that you'll ever find salvation is in the name of Jesus Christ. Hey, thank God, as the Bible says, that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. We find ourselves so many times wondering, how can I get out of the mess that I'm sitting in? It's only through Christ. I want to tell you this today, just like the disciples, church people, they will literally attack people that are not as worthy. Oh, yes. I wonder 7 years ago tomorrow, Brother Chester, when you walked in and you didn't have a tie on and you didn't have a shirt and you were sitting there probably with alcohol on your breath, maybe still in a little state of mind that you couldn't even focus, hey, because of the drugs and the addiction that was in your life. Hey, I wonder today if people still look at you today as they did then. And you know what the answer is? Absolutely not. You know why? Because there's something about Christian people that seem to be okay when somebody walks in and looks good and seem to have it all figured out. Hey, but let me say it this way. We ain't got to worried about what they look like. We ain't got to worry about where they come from. We ain't got to worry about changing our life. We ain't got to worry about pushing our standard on them. Hey, the Bible says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things passed away and all things become new. Hey, would to God today we get to Jesus and be able to let him see it's not just church, it's the Lord Jesus Christ. But just like Chester was probably 8 years ago or 7 years ago, you know what happened? They attacked you and said, he'll never be nothing. They alienated you. They pushed you to the side because you didn't fit their mold. And when you, amen, preach on, Brother Jason, preach on. They sit down in the pew and they get to a place to where they smell a little different. They ain't got the money to be able to buy deodorant, so you're looking at them and trying to worry what nasty hole they just crawled out of. That person sits down between you and your children, and they're sitting over there, and because of the late night they had last night, you can smell the alcohol coming off their breath, and you begin to alienate them. You'll shake hands with brother so-and-so that's a deacon. You'll shake hands with brother so-and-so that's a preacher. You'll shake hands with brother so-and-so that's Sunday school. Oh, you'll even touch it. You'll shake hands. Hey, with that lady that sings in the choir, you'll go back and talk to the people. They got it all figured out. Hey, but would to God that we'd swallow our pride and realize where we came from and realize that vote for Jesus Christ that reached down to where we was and picked us up by the miry clay. We would never know the grace of God like we know today. We would never know the forgiveness of God like we know today. But today we've messed up and alienated people and pushed them away. You know why people won't come to church? Disciples. 2015, a.k.a. followers. Alienate them. I'm preaching myself for a minute. No, I don't, Brother Jason. When's the last time you took one of them out to eat? Huh? When's the last time still worried about where you... Amen. I'm preaching myself. You and your family was going out to eat after supper, that you forgot about your plans that you said about a week ago, and you see the person like Brother Brian or somebody that's in church for a long time, say, brother, you know what? I'm going to take you to eat lunch. Oh, yeah, I'll preach it right, and I'm going to preach it plain. You better believe it. Because that's why people don't want to come back to church. That's why people don't want to be around church folk, because they get pushed aside and they begin to have this image that, listen, not only will God not accept me, but the reason why God won't accept me is because I'm unwealthy and I'm unworthy and I have nothing, I'm unclean and all these things. You say, well, how do you know that, brother? I mean, what do you mean that God don't love you? I mean, if you just get saved, and he'd say, oh, but Brother Jason, I really want to get saved and I want to get right. But listen, I know God's mad at me. God ain't going to talk. But how do you know that, brother? I mean, just tell me so I can pray with you. Well, I'll tell you, Brother Jason, hey, that hypocrite sitting on the first pew, and that hypocrite sitting on the second pew, and that hypocrite sitting back in the sound booth, and that hypocrite, man, preach on, Brother Jason, preach on. And that hypocrite sitting up in the choir singing, that act like they love Jesus and lift up their holy hands. Every time they walk by me, they don't talk to me, they don't look at me, they don't speak to me, they don't pray with me, but every time I'm on Facebook, they'll talk about me, they'll say something about me, and they'll put me down. But I know God don't love me, because God's people don't love me either. And you want to know why? That's why. That's why. Am I condoning the sin? I'll say the same woman that's caught in adultery, I'll say the same thing that Jesus looked at her. Go and sin no more. But you better believe, you know how he could say that and she walked away never sinned? Because she had a Savior that stood up for her when nobody else would. And listen, transitioned himself from being the righteous to making the bridge to be able to draw her to where she needed to go. Hey, listen, that's true discipleship. Somebody that's saved by the grace of God and reaching down to pick somebody up that's weak and don't have it all figured out, getting down and helping them up and saying, now listen, brother, as you take that first step, you might want to think about your friends. And listen, brother, as you take that second step, you might want to think about your environment. And listen, brother, as you think about, you want to think about how your stewardship, you ought to give to God, you ought to love God, you ought to serve God. And the more you invest in somebody, the more you'll lead somebody. The reason why we've lost influence is because we don't invest. Amen. Listen, there might not be but about 20 in here today that's thinking, preach on, Brother Jason, preach on, but there's 20 of them. Because they're the Samaritan that's sitting by the way wondering why in the world nobody will talk or help or pick them up. I got news for you. I don't care how young or how old, how black, how white, how purple, how green, and how much money you got in the bank. Every single one of us, we were just like that Samaritan. We had no way to get to Jesus. We had no way to get to God. We had no way to get to heaven. Hey, but God came and sent his son to die on the cross, as the Bible says, rose on the third day. And thank the Lord today, as we find ourselves to be complete in him, we shall be set free. Let me hurry this morning. Bible says that Jesus began to look at him. And what was so ironic is this man by the name of Jesus that was so right, that knew everything. I mean, I'm talking about the sinless Son of God, the very one that had the heritage, the bloodline, listen to me, to be qualified and to be trusted. The irony of it is, you thought that he would not went to the woman at the well, that he did went to a leader or a priest in Samaria. You'd have thought that maybe instead of being able to go to that individual, that he'd have turned around and he'd have went back to somebody that had a little bit of information and actually could fix some things. I mean, you'd have thought that that's what Jesus would have done. You'd have thought that Jesus, to be able to, listen to me, to be able to reach somebody, that he would aimlessly throw something out on Facebook hoping somebody sees it and gets saved. But that's not what Jesus did. He went to that individual by himself. And it wasn't just a Samaritan, and it wasn't just a woman, but it was somebody that was unworthy in everybody's eyes that deserved anything. And Jesus says, I'm going to take time for her. I'll make haste to be to the end of my message this morning, but I want to ask you a question today. Whether you're saved or whether you're not saved, whether you're lost or where you know you're going to heaven, it makes no difference. Listen to me. I wonder today if in the back of your heart, behind the mask and the callous that's sitting there, listen to me, if you're wondering if Christ will take time for you today. I wonder if there's a married couple here that knows the Lord, they're saved, they're wondering, would the Lord take time for me? We're in the ministry, this might be your heart. We've been serving the Lord and we're working and we're doing everything, but you know, our marriage, we're ashamed of our marriage, and you know, people don't want to hang out with us because we ain't doing the same thing they are, and our convictions ain't the same as theirs, and our kids don't look and dress like theirs. And man, you're beat up today. I got time. I got news for you. Jesus has got time for you. Jesus has got time for you. The amazing thing to me was this, is why in the world did he send his disciples away? Verse number 8, the Bible says he walked away and he said, I must go through Samaritan. You know why? Listen to me. Because Jesus, hello, listen to me, church. Because Jesus understood very well that sometimes those that are always with you don't always understand the burden within you. Listen to me. Those that's always with you don't always understand the burden within you. These people that were closest to Jesus alienated that woman. They attacked that woman. They begin to push her away. And Jesus says, no. He says, that ain't going to happen, so this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to send you boys on a little walk, and I'm going to let you walk away because I'm going to go over here because there's somebody I got to talk to. And the amazing thing is that Jesus had enough wisdom to be able to understand that the people closest to him was probably causing him the most trouble and controversy and probably hindering his evangelism, if you want to say it that way. Now let me park right there for a minute. Sometimes in the church house, the closest people to the preachers who think that everything's all right are the ones that's hindering those getting to Jesus. Because those that's been in church for a long time and those that serve and teach in Sunday school. And listen, I'm not just preaching to anybody. I'm preaching to everybody, going to preach it straight. Hey, because I'm telling you right now, there's a lot of people, and I don't care if it's preachers, pastors, deacons, hey, the wives, I don't care if it's their children, I don't care what it is. Hey, every time it begins to happen, there's always seemed to be this little wall, and here it is. It seems like that everything's just fine, and you've got these 10 and 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 these 10, and you've got hundreds and thousands out there, and you're wondering, why don't the church grow? Why don't the ministry grow? Why don't things happen? It's because these people that's closest to us are alienating the people that ain't like them, and because of their criticism, and because of their mouth, and because of their judgment, people are dying and going to hell because nobody will ever accept them for who they are. Yeah. Now let me ask you a question this morning. What seat are you in? Is the Lord sending you away so he can actually speak to somebody's heart? I wonder how many of us sit on the church pew and it's the Christians distracting those that are unsaved. I'm in the Bible and I'm going to give you an outline in a minute, but I'm preaching it straight. The Bible says he sent them away. And listen, I love the Lord and I thank God, but ain't nothing that makes me more fired up and aggravated and irritated. It's a fact for me to be able to go out and try to reach somebody and try to love somebody and listen and get past myself, because you got to understand, I'm flesh just like you. When somebody attacks God's people and God's children and God's man and different things, and they begin to sow discord, I mean, it upsets me because I love my church family and it begins to break my heart. Hey, but in the midst of that, I've got to swallow my pride and go to them and say, hey, brother, I want you to know that I love you. And man, I've been praying for you. And I just want you to know if I could do anything, let me know. Well, Brother Jason, you could, but you ain't the problem. What do you mean, brother? I'll tell you what it is. Well, you know, so-and-so and so-and-so. I know y'all are friends, Brother Jason. But, and you know, so-and-so's wife. And I know y'all are friends, Brother Jason. You
You don't know the way they look at me. Whenever they're around you, they're all right. And they want to be fine and they want to shake hands. And they want to take me out. Hey, but when it's behind closed doors and you ain't standing there, hey, they're hypocritical. They're talking about me. They're talking about my family. They're talking about my wife. And Brother Jason, I'm just confused. I'm overwhelmed and I don't want to go back to church because that church just ain't for me. Oh, by the way, Brother Jason, because where those that was closest to you begin to talk in their own house and their kids have got more mouth than what they know wisdom, they begin to speak. My kids don't even want to go back because now the very things that those that's closest begin to speak is filtered down to the children, and now the children are speaking to the children, and my family's not welcome. Dying and going to hell. Broken. As we sit back on Facebook and looking at their pictures, talking about them, and the reason they're filling their mouth up and their soul up with the bottle and they're popping the pills and they're smoking their weed and they're running around doing things and cussing and fussing and partying, it's because they're trying to fill the void that the church put in them when they thought that God should love them and God's people should love them. And then it got to the Lord and it felt like they could almost taste victory and they could almost taste love and they could almost see mercy and grace, and it seems like everything was fine. And then right in the midst of that moment, it seemed like they were smacked down and their heart was ripped out of them, no longer to ever be accepted. So all they could do is take what the world has offered.
You're preaching, brother.
I've got a cousin that's like a brother to me right now, 35 years old. Won't darken the door of a church because of it. And listen, I'm not a perfect man, but I've been saved for 12 years. And man, I've tried to give God everything, and he's seen my tough times, my heartaches, my failures, my struggles. I can't get him in church. Because there was a disciple somewhere, critical. And before you go wonder if I'm in the Bible, then you figure out why in the world that when blind Bartimaeus got over there, you think disciples and people close to Jesus don't have a big issue? Then you tell me why blind Bartimaeus was in a situation. They was trying to tell him, just hush up. You're too loud. You're too noisy. And he says, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus is passing by. And then the disciples are trying to get him to hush. It wasn't the harlots. It wasn't those that was gambling. It wasn't those that was doing something wrong. It was the very disciples that followed Jesus. They had seen the miracles. They had seen God do things. And it was those people telling them, hush your mouth up. What about the woman that had a daughter? And in the midst of it, they begin to tell her, you need to be quiet. You need to hush. You ever wonder why so many people quit coming? Maybe it's simply because those that's closest have not put away childish things. Amen. Preach on, preach on. Preach on. That's the Bible. 1 Corinthians chapter number 13. You study it. He says, chapter of love. I know it is, but it talks about when I became a man, I put away childish things. Listen, when you became a woman, the woman that God wants you to be, you put away childish things and you start seeing people for who they are and identify them for where you were and be able to learn how to be able to take. A true Christian don't just identify. Listen, what we need today is not people to talk about the problems. We need somebody to be able to help us with the solution. Amen. Amen. Listen, I want to reach people. I'm tired of a domino effect. These people come in, these people come out, and it's like little seeds. Everybody, they'll come one week, come another week, come one week. Hey, why don't we just invest and take somebody in? Well, I'm not a pastor. I don't get paid to do that. Well, that's all right. I don't know if Jesus got paid to die on the cross for your sins either. Matter of fact, he suffered and gave his life. So true love ain't actually paying about something. True love's actually giving something. That's what the Bible says. So if you want to love somebody the way that God loved you and he gave his son to die on the cross for your sin, to where Jesus Christ comes, the Bible says that he might be able to make the sins for us, for he came not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Maybe you need to give some time to somebody else. Very quickly, I want to say this to you. I want you to notice really quick. Miss Deborah, you come. Stay with me, please. I want to show you something. I want to show you the Bible real quick. Listen. Will you just notice with me real quick in verse number 9, the words of this lady. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, listen to this. How is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which
am I a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Can you see her attitude in that? How is it that thou, being a Jew? In other words, this woman that had, listen to me. This woman that had been rejected, can you see her attitude? You know why some people bite our heads off? Because they done seen our kind. And when somebody gets a burden to tell them about the Lord, say, what are you doing here? You don't want to be seen with me? What are you going out to eat with me for? I mean, you're offended that this is going to happen or that's going to happen or my Facebook status ain't like it. What in the world you want to hang out with me for? Because I've messed up before and I've sinned before. And literally, she's looking at Jesus. And she's got this attitude like, why in the world take time for me? And you know how many people feel the same way? It's in the book. Read it. It's there. The Bible says right after that, notice this. Verse number 10. Jesus answered, said unto her, if thou knewest. He didn't come off and say, well, bless God, if you get your heart right, you might know what to do. Amen. You see what happened? Listen. She comes. She's mad. Angry, upset, abused, rejected, hurt, scarred. Look up here. You might be here today and you're scarred. Let me say this. The hardest people to reach are those who have been scarred. Scarred. Here she is. She's thinking, why are you even going to talk to me? And in response to this, Jesus says, but wait a minute, but if thou knewest the gift. In other words, he didn't correct her and he didn't make her feel stupid. He began to enlighten her, almost give her a curiosity. Listen to me. There's people that are dying and going to hell. No longer in churches, out of this church. They're broken, they're bitter, they're scarred. Yes, they might be saved, but they're not growing. Their families are crumbling. And instead of giving them a Bible principle and being direct, you know what Jesus says, but if thou knewest the gift. In other words, could I take a moment just to tell you what I'm really here for? Yeah. You imagine how many doors would open up if we take that approach? I'm not condoning that, brother. Just give me a second. Jesus had to humble himself. You know what that's called? Positioning yourself for God to use you. Amen. That's what, when I talk about husbands and wives, position. In other words, don't do what you think you ought to do. Just do what God tells you to. The Bible says that, responds, says, give me a chance. Listen to this. Notice this text. Following. Verse number 11. She calls him, sir. She says, the woman said to him, sir. Notice verse number 19, if you will. Follow along. The Bible says, the woman said to him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Go down, if you will, to verse number 25. The woman saith unto him, I know the Messiah cometh. What are you saying, Brother Jason? Listen to me. When you begin to humble yourself, and you begin to take time to transition yourself, people's bitterness and callous and the wall that they have built up, sir, you don't know who I am. Who do you think you are? Why in the world would you talk to me? I'm a Samaritan. I'm a drunk. I'm a harlot. I messed up, walked away from church. I used to sing in the choir and I quit because they told me I shouldn't come back and I was tainting their image. Why in the world talk to me? Why? Jesus said, just give me a chance. She goes from that to sir. From a sir to a prophet, from a prophet to Messiah. She began to let down her guard where she was starting to see the gospel. She was starting to see it. And the Bible says that Jesus, when he began to do these things, he began to speak to her. And I want to say this, and I'm done. Stay with me. Write this down. Here was their conversation, a different look. Have a different listen to the conversation as he approached her. Number one, they talked about the wells. I don't have time to go into it, but if you were to go back, she said, listen to me, stay with me, I'm almost done. I want to help you. There might be somebody here. Let me make this. There might be somebody here, and you need to know. I want to help you this morning. There might be somebody here, you're saved, and you got somebody that's on your heart, and you're burdened for them, and you're really just trying to help. You need to know what to do. Let me say, he talked about the wells. You know what he said? She says, I come for Jacob's well. He says, yeah, but I'm the well for the spiritual life. That's the well for the earthly life. She began to conversate with him and begin to talk. And what he began to do is he began to separate these very two things by saying, okay, but here you come, but I'm the one that's here. If you drink of me, you'll never thirst again. So he identified himself almost as a well, a source from where you get from. Everybody with me? Say amen. A source from where you get from. He said, now look, you can take of this and you'll thirst again. He said, but you drink out of this well and you'll be satisfied. Listen to me today. I don't have a lot to tell you, and I don't have a lot of deep theology. But there's just one thing that I always try to speak and tell people. It's simple. When you really look unto Jesus, holy, everything, whatever you need, you'll be satisfied. But look unto him is to trust him. The second thing he talked about was the water, because he made it plain. He said, look, he said, you come. He said, but I come to be able to have, get me a drink. The Bible says, if you notice in the text, the woman said to him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with. So the conversation was about the source, the well. The conversation was about the water. She was confused because she was in a place where she literally did not know what to do. Look at me. Look at me. You'll miss this because now the hour's getting long and we're ready to get out of here. So stay with me. So many people come to a well. They think they need what they need is down there, and they can't ever separate the two of what they really need and what they don't need. So many people, this is what he was doing. So many people come to church and they see the well and they see the water they want. This is it. But until they ever see what they have not been seeing, they'll never get what they need to get. In other words, listen, he says, you got to look to me. Everybody's coming to this well looking for the same thing you're looking for. But if you'll see what you need to see, you'll be satisfied. As a pastor, I'm telling you, quit looking at church and preachers and choirs and people and even heroes. Look unto Jesus.
Right. Amen.
And man, that's why when I say we come here to lift up the Lord, man, you need more than a sermon and an outline. You need an intimate relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, because all of this is just, man, an enjoyment and an excitement for me to be able to come and thank him. Because when I hooked up with the living water and I realized who Jesus Christ really was, man, he changed my life. And then I begin to come to church and, man, I begin to shed off the sin of my life, and I begin to serve him and sing and follow. And man, this is just the fruit of the goodness of God. And God has been so good. But you don't get good and get God. You got to get God.
Amen.
And then you get good.
Amen.
I got to pull this out and I'm done. I won't go all the way through it. They also talked about her wickedness. You know what we do? We don't ever want to talk about somebody's problems. Let's be honest. Everybody listen to me. We don't want to talk about it. Because we're afraid if we go up and say, hey, brother, I know you've been messing up, and I know you've been drinking, and I know you've been partying, and I know you've been gossiping, and I know you've been saved, and you split that church over there. We do that, listen, because we push them away. You know why you push them away? Hey, listen, newsflash, deep point right here. You push them away because you have no influence, because you've never invested. Listen to me, college and careers, teenagers, moms, dad, we have no influence because we never invested. You know why Jesus could say, oh, they got five husbands? I mean, he called her out. He said, oh, no. Let me tell you, you ain't just messing around with one man. You ain't messing around with just two. He said, you got five. I'm calling right five. Most of the people have been like, bless God, you don't know me. Who are you to call me out? But she didn't do that. You know why? Because he invested. Invested. Hey, and even those that were close to him, they didn't understand why he reached down to her. She saw that. Let me say this. Don't let your family cripple your testimony because you're too shallow of a backbone to stand for God's word, and all you'll do is just stay with the family. If your family's perspective is not godly, Don't be like your family. Amen. 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 I'll listen to it, but I ain't got to agree with it. Amen. You want to know why children don't accept people? You want to know why this young age group so many times are trying to tiptoe in churches, seeing where they can go anymore? Hey, because it's that generation that has hurt so much, and everybody's been so critical and hypocritical because they looked at this, and my mama's good, and my daddy's good. My papa was this way. He told me that you could judge a book by its covers, and you see them, they'll run together. Yes, they'll run together. But let me say this. If not for the grace of God, where would you be? Every time it's me and my wife and even my little boy, I'm done. We'll be talking about some things. And as a husband, men, listen to me. As a husband, it's my job to help them see things sometimes they don't see. Sometimes it's the other way around. I get clouded by something and my wife will say, "Now, yeah, but you didn't see that, did you?" See, those closest to you, they can either help you or they can hinder you. Amen. Amen. Listen, I'm an independent Baptist pastor and I'm proud to know why I am. But there's some independent Baptist pastors that won't ever preach behind that pulpit, hey, because they got a lot more mindsets and a lot more hard things that ain't biblical. It's in their mind. And I'm not going to let hurt people that come to church for the first time. I want to disciple them, get them saved by the grace of God, be able to live for God, be able to know what the goodness of God is. I go both ways. It makes no difference. I ain't going to get a carnal man up here to be able to preach something that ain't Bible either. Y'all with me? Say amen. Here's the invitation. I'm done. Who needs a different look? Who needs to get a different look? Who needs to give a different look? I wonder today how many of us can think of somebody.
As the pastor, I want to thank you for viewing our video today. However, if God's dealt with your heart, we do not want to end this video without giving you a chance to be able to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. If you're there today and God's actually dealing with your heart, I want to remind you what the Bible says, "For all have sinned, come short of the glory of God." That means every single one of us has had problems, issues, sin, failures, faults in our past. But the great thing is this, is that Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh through the Father but by me." There is a way to be able to have hope, to have eternal security within the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to know that you're saved by the grace of God. Now the great thing about the Bible is it tells us about the love of God. He says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." And that's amazing to a lot of people, and they can quote it. But the beauty of it is this, is the very next verse tells us the purpose of Christ. Because the Bible says, "For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved." That means that God sent His Son to die for those of us who are sinners, so that we can have fellowship with God Himself. Now, if you're there today and God's really been dealing with your heart, I want to ask you this question. Do you really believe that God's been dealing with you about salvation? If that's the case today, then I want to tell you what you need to do is repent of your sins. You need to die to yourself. Admit that you're lost and you're on your way to hell. And then look at what the Bible tells us, that He tells us that we can be saved through Christ. Who do you call on? There's only one. As the Bible says, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." It's only through Christ and Christ alone. So I tell you today, would you trust in Christ? I want to ask you, would you trust in Him as a personal Savior? You say, "Brother Jason, I don't really know if I can do that." Well, let me tell you, the Bible also tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It don't matter who you are, where you come from. God sent His Son to die for everyone. If you've made this decision today to be able to trust in Christ, to be able to die to yourself, to be able to start living for Christ and accept Him as a personal Savior after repenting, would you do us a favor and be able to contact us at 336-788-0551 and let us know about this decision that you made so we can start praying for you. Thank you so much.